The oppressed shall rise together, or together we will fall. They're turning the whole planet to a sacrifice zone. For an injury to one is an injury to all. They're turning the whole planet to a sacrifice zone. Everywhere we go, we will make your story known. We won't just let you die alone. If the sacrifice continues, the next one may be our own. No more sacrifice zones. No more sacrifice zones. No more sacrifice zones. No more sacrifice zones.
And thank you, Ben, for the song, which is appropriate. It fits right into the war against the people idea. In fact, the whole world is becoming a sacrifice zone for the 1%. We'll talk about that. Ben's music is great, and I love the songs, but it's just weird hearing it from coming from a guy with such short hair. I mean, in my day, we had folk music, but people had longer hair. What I want to do today is two things. To talk a little bit about my new book, War Against the People, but I think a lot of people come to hear me and I'm sort of more identified with the whole issue of Israel-Palestine. And since that's in the news and has been in the news for a long, long time and is really reaching another height of crisis, I thought I'd also spend time, maybe a little bit more time actually, on the whole question of where are we headed in Israel-Palestine. Why should we care about Israel-Palestine so much? Why has this become such a huge issue in the world? I mean, there's 1,000 other conflicts. You can't really compare conflicts and suffering, but from the point of view of scale and violence, the Congo will certainly be a much, in a sense, I think that's almost the worst conflict. But the question is, why has this really become a global issue? And it really has. I think the issue of Israel-Palestine has reached the proportions of the anti-apartheid struggle. Of course, people like Dershowitz and, you know, the pro-Israel people consider that anti-Semitism with everything else. Why are we focused on Israel rather than on the Congo or on Tibet or on, racism in this country? You know, why is Israel the fetish, the preoccupation of the UN and the international community? You know, it's because of anti-Semitism, of course. But in fact, I mean, there is, I think, a disproportionate attention to this. But I think it's reflected by the fact that it's really a conflict that disrupts the entire international system. This isn't simply a spat between two peoples in some faraway corner of the world. It obviously is happening within the context of the Middle East, which is one of the most volatile parts of the world. The United States is fighting 5 or 6 wars in the Middle East. So obviously, it's important from that point of view. And in fact, Israel-Palestine didn't create all the problems in the Middle East, but I think Kerry, the Secretary of State, who I don't agree with always, was right when he said that you're not going to begin to address the meltdown in the Middle East and the conflicts and the polarizations and everything until you resolve the Israel-Palestine conflict. It's this source of aggravation all the time, of disruption, of destabilization. You know, Israel is a country the size of New Jersey. And yet last week, President Obama signed a bill giving Israel $40 billion in new arms over a 10-year period, from 2018 to 2028. And that's on top of the $30 billion in the previous 10 years that Bush gave in 2008. So over a 20-year period, in the most volatile area of the world, The United States is giving $70 billion to one country that its own Secretary of State says is really the epicenter of the conflict. $70 billion to a country the size of New Jersey. So obviously this is a huge subsidy to the American arms industry, which is a big part of it. So we have to put it within that context as well. But, you know, what is, you know, what's the quid pro quo? Why is the United States doing that? So it really shows, in a sense, how much Israel stands at the center of what I think is misguided American policy in the Middle East. And, of course, then the conflict in the Middle East, that's largely fueled by the Israel-Palestine conflict, radiates out. So, you know, you can't get on an airplane with a tube of toothpaste these days. So all our preoccupations with insecurity and terrorism, I mean, I flew here from Louisville, Kentucky. I must have heard the word security 1,000 times in the airport before I left. This whole preoccupation also stems largely from this part of the world. So there's a lot riding on resolving this conflict. Another reason why it should concern us is because this is the main challenge to human rights in the world. I mean, human rights means, I don't think it's completely come to the United States, the idea of human rights. But in the rest of the world, it's very important. Bush once said when he was president that human rights is a conspiracy, you know, against the United States, against, how do you phrase it? Like the unilateralism of the United States, something like that. And so, you know, and there's a good chance, you know, and Israel actually thinks it's done, that an occupation and the imprisoning of an entire people, the Palestinian people, is doable and will actually happen, that the occupation could actually win. And if that happened, in the Holy Land, no less, on the southern border of Europe, you know, in the spotlights of TV cameras, that would set back our whole idea of human rights and international law to square one. I mean, the effect would be chilling, not only, of course, for the Palestinians, but for all oppressed peoples of the world for whom human rights are this way out. So there's a lot riding on resolving this conflict the right way. Because if we don't, it has global implications from the point of view of the military industries, the great powers, and the enemies of human rights prevailing. And then where are we? And there's another thing that kind of relates to that, and that is that this conflict, and certainly the occupation itself, is not seen by most peoples of the world, and I would include Europe in this, as an Israeli occupation. It's seen as an Israeli-American occupation. It's hard to convey how much the United States is implicated in all of this, which it is. Israel couldn't maintain the occupation for a month without the American political umbrella and the economic support and the military support that the United States gives to Israel. So, you know, it's hard for me to convey to Americans how much that's isolating the United States in the world. And when you have repeated UN resolutions, and not only in Israel-Palestine, on other issues that have to do with human rights and arms control and control of landmines and cluster bombs and all kinds of things in the UN, and the vote is the United States, Israel, and Micronesia against everybody else, well, that really sends a chilling message to the world community that the United States is hostile to human rights and to justice. So that radiating out of this conflict, going on and on and on, sort of, I think is something that should really, a situation that should really concern Americans in terms of, you know, do you really want to be a part of the world and be on the right side of history and be a moral force and a good force, or where you are today, which is, in many ways, Israel-Palestine is a microcosm of the wider world. And in a sense, the Palestinians, one reason why it's a global issue is because the Palestinians are an emblematic people. For the oppressed peoples of the world, and I include the people of Ferguson in that, the Palestinians are this little people, no army, a grain of sand in the global machine, that are standing up against American neocolonialism, American imperialism, really, American militarism, as it's expressed through Israel, that gets $40 billion in new arms from Obama. And that really, I mean, they've become kind of the what would you say, the flagship or the symbol, the emblem of oppressed peoples all over the world, whereas Israel has become the flower child of the global north, of really the militaristic, oppressive global north, of which the United States, of course, is the major power. So in many ways, how this plays out, you know, has a global impact for peoples. It's almost like the playing out of the much wider global conflicts between the global north that's trying to maintain its control as the capitalist system becomes more and more unsustainable and repressive, versus the poor people of the world who are trying to carve out some kind of existence for themselves. So for all those kinds of reasons, this really is a conflict of global proportions, and that's why it should preoccupy us. So what do we do about it? There is actually a simple, straightforward, agreed upon almost solution to this conflict. And that is the two-state solution. The two-state solution is pretty, like I said, straightforward. This is one country. The Jews call it the Land of Israel. Palestinians call it Palestine. Religious people call it the Holy Land. Whatever you call it, it's one integral country in which there are two national groups today. Whether there should be or shouldn't be, that's another question. But today there's Palestinian Arabs and Israeli Jews. The concept of the two-state solution is let's partition the country between those two people. Let's have a state of Israel and alongside of it a Palestinian state. Now, if you look at the map, it's not exactly a fair and just solution, because the Palestinians, first of all, just geographically, if this is the map, Israel remains on 78% of the country. And the Palestinian state that would emerge alongside of it is on only 22%. The West Bank, East Jerusalem, including the Old City, and Gaza. And it's especially unjust and unfair if we recall that half the population of this country today is Palestinian. And in 5 years, there'll be a Palestinian majority in this country. And that's before any of the 5 million refugees living around come back. So in other words, the majority population, that's the indigenous population, that in 1947 owned almost the whole country, 94% of the land, would only get 22% of the country. So the fact that the Palestinians accepted this two-state solution in 1988, we're talking about 30 years ago almost, the PLO accepted this, is amazing. It's unprecedented. I don't think ever in history did a colonized people give up political claim to 78% of their country, to their colonial oppressors, basically. The Palestinians did that and recognized the state of Israel on 78% of the country. It wasn't enough for Israel because Israel says, no, that's not enough to recognize us as a state. You have to recognize us as a Jewish state. So Israel's demanding that the Palestinians become Zionists and actually sacrifice the civil liberties of Palestinian citizens of Israel who aren't Jewish in order to get any kind of negotiations move forward. But the fact is that the Palestinians never got any credit for bending over more than backwards to accept a reality in which they give up 78% of their country. Instead, they've been demonized as terrorists, as being intransigent, there's no partner for peace. And Israel, who's an occupying power for the last 50 years, becomes the victim. So the whole thing gets turned on its head, with, of course, the support of the United States, which is the most important and almost unanimous Congress, both houses, both parties. Hillary Clinton is worse than Trump on this issue, we should know. Trump at least said in the debate he's willing to look at both sides, and then got attacked by Rubio, who said all the Arabs are terrorists. Hillary Clinton would never say that. Hillary Clinton is so pro-Israel, blindly pro-Israel, that I think she would be a disaster in this. And Bernie Sanders isn't great either, if you look at his voting record. He's kind of kept quiet on this. So, you know, Israel has both parties, from Bernie Sanders to Rick Santorum, in its corner. And that's how it thinks it can prevail here. So that the fact that the Palestinians agreed to recognize the state of Israel and make peace with it 30 years ago carries no weight. They get no credit for it. It has no political implications for them at all. And not only that, but the two-state solution was endorsed unanimously by the Arab League in 2002. So if Israel genuinely wanted peace, security, recognition, integration into the Middle East region, it could have had that 30 years ago, plus 78% of the country. Whoa. What's better than that? That's a pretty generous offer. And instead, and the United States, of course, is in favor, on paper at least, of the two-state solution. The international community is. It's across the board. So why didn't we sign the paper 30 years ago and be done with this? Can you imagine if there had been peace here 30 years ago? How that would have impacted on the Middle East in general? Where might we have been today if this had been resolved 30 years ago? But there was one holdout. One party said no. Israel. Israel said no. We want the entire country. Why should we settle for 78% if we can get 100%? And of course, Israel has always denied, always, from 67 on, that it even has an occupation. That's why the Fourth Geneva Convention that protects people living under occupation, that would have prevented the building of settlements, that would have prevented the destruction of the Palestinian economy, was never applied. Israel's a signatory in the Fourth Geneva Convention, but it says we're a signatory, but it doesn't apply because this isn't an occupation. You can't occupy your own country, you see? And so Israel has always claimed the entire country. And in fact, a term that we use in Israel that is a term you don't hear often, but it's very important, is Judaization, which sounds at face value almost anti-Semitic, except it's a term that the Israeli government uses officially. We're Judaizing the Galilee. We're Judaizing Jerusalem. And Judaization has been the Zionist project for the last 100 years, and it's been expressly so. Which means the Judaization process is transforming Palestine into the land of Israel. Changing the place names, replacing the populations, and de-Arabizing Palestine and Judaizing the land of Israel. And I would submit to you that that process has been completed. It's over. What Israel is doing today with these 7-year-old kids with scissors that are walking around trying to stab people, Israel is basically mopping up. It's not political. Israel sees this as a last desperate gasp of some kind of resistance, and then it's over. We finished the project. There is no more occupation. The West Bank has become Judea and Samaria. And the Palestinians that are half the population of this country are locked into 10% of the land. And that in dozens of little tiny islands. Even in Israel itself, the Palestinian citizens of Israel, who are 20% of the population, are confined by law and zoning to 3.5% of the land. 94% of the land of the state of Israel, of the country in which they're citizens, is off limits to non-Jews. Non-Jews cannot buy land, cannot lease land, can't rent houses on land. 94% of the country, which is reserved for Jews. So that we have today, I would submit, a super apartheid regime with the support of the United States, which hasn't escaped the attention of the peoples of the world. As the United States is going all over the world with its army, trying to impose democracy all over the world, here's the little people that's saying, please, a little democracy would be very nice. And the United States is actually supporting the forces of repression. And of course, it's not only political, I'm not going to get into this now, but what Israel has done to ensure its control permanently is to create facts on the ground, we call them, that are so massive that they prejudice any negotiations. I mean, Israel's willing to negotiate, but only if the outcome is predetermined. We're not going to go into the negotiations and lose. And so the facts on the ground do that. If anyone can tell me how a Palestinian state's going to emerge from this, you should win the Nobel Peace Prize. In other words, Israel has systematically and deliberately eliminated the two-state solution. That solution could have worked. And we actually, in the Israeli peace movement, we supported the two-state solution. I supported it. It's not fair and just, but if the Palestinians accepted it, that's good enough for me. And it could have worked. The Palestinians would have had some coherent territory. They would have had a seaport, an airport, agriculture. They would have had Jerusalem and Bethlehem as a resource, which isn't bad for tourism. They would have had borders with Jordan and with Egypt. They could have made a go of it. And they wanted to, because a two-state solution is the only culmination of a national liberation struggle that the Palestinians were going through. But Israel eliminated that. It eliminated, and I'm trying to convince J Street, who are liberal Jews. I mean, they're liberals, and they're educated, that this is gone, and we have to stop talking about it, and they're holding on to it. Why do they hold on to it? Because as Zionists, liberal Zionists maybe, that believe Israel has to be a Jewish state, they can't go anywhere except the two-state solution. This is the only solution that somehow leaves Israel a Jewish state, even though almost 30% of Israeli citizens are not Jewish. But let's say a Jewish state, the only way you can possibly justify that is in a two-state solution. And if that's gone, then they're really in a bind. And so they assert that it still exists, even though they can't make a case for it. You know, and if you can't make a case for your political position, it's a pretty weak position. And so Israel, of course, has fragmented the territories. 90% of the Palestinians live in these little areas of A and B, which are 40% of the West Bank. And Area C, which is all the gray area all around, is where the settlements are. So there's 200 settlements, all these blue areas, and the pink areas are the settlement blocks, the big blocks of settlements that Israel's created, so that you can see that Area C completely surrounds and encloses and isolates. Look how tiny some of these areas A and B are. So that Israel has basically confined, like I said, the Palestinians to tiny enclaves. 600,000 Israelis live in the occupied territory. And in 4 years, according to Israeli plans, there'll be 1 million Israelis. Now, you put that together with some kind of a two-state solution. It just isn't going to be. And the United States has even ceased protesting Israeli settlement building. You know, when Hillary Clinton was Secretary of State and Israel declared its building 5,000 housing units in the West Bank, she would issue a statement saying that's unhelpful. That's as tough as it got. Today, you don't even get that. There's no reaction at all. It's understood that it's done. It's over. And so Israel, like I said, has eliminated the two-state solution. And just in case you still didn't get the message, it built a wall, you know, twice as high as the Berlin Wall, 5 times longer than the Berlin Wall, that imprisons, actually. The Berlin Wall was at least linear. This one imprisons tens of thousands of Palestinians in cells. This is the city of Tul Karm. 70,000 people completely surrounded by a wall with an exit and entrance controlled by the Israeli army. And I don't want to get involved with American politics. This is the wall in Bethlehem. When she was Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton went and stood in front of this wall, almost in this spot, and said, and I'm quoting, "This fence," because Israel won't allow you to use the word wall, "this fence is an appropriate, nonviolent response to terrorism." So that's where we're going with the liberals in the United States. And the wall, of course, then completely imprisons the Palestinians in what Israel calls cantons, a canton in the north, a canton in the center, a canton in the south, and then the cage of Gaza, while at the same time incorporating the settlements, you can see, and Greater Jerusalem into Israel proper. It's clear, if you look at the wall, that Israel sells as a security barrier against terrorism, that that's absolutely not the case. I mean, the wall has nothing to do with the border. Here's the border. You can't tell me the wall comes out to here for security reasons. It's clear that it's imprisoning on one side and it's a land grab on the other side. So where does that leave us then? With this conflict that is so disruptive of the entire international system and actually so destructive of American interests, if you want to put it in an American context, not to mention the rights of the Palestinians. Where does this leave us in terms of where we should be going? Well, it seems to me mathematically, although anthropologists aren't great mathematicians, I got to admit, but mathematically, it seems to me there's 3 possible outcomes to this conflict. One of them is the two-state solution that, again, could have worked, was accepted by the Palestinians and everybody else, including the United States, was accepted by the Israeli peace movement, but is simply gone. It's over. It's done. It's dead. And we have to stop talking about it. Because the more you talk about a solution that's irrelevant, the more you're simply muddying the waters. It's gone. So where are we then? Well, the second option is apartheid. And that's where we are today. When Israel eliminated the two-state solution, it didn't only eliminate the two-state solution. It created one country. There is already one state between the Mediterranean and the Jordan River. The whole discussion of two states, one state is over. There is one state today. There's one government between the Mediterranean and the Jordan River. And don't go telling me the Palestinian Authority is an effective government. There's only one army, obviously. There's only one currency. Whether you're in Gaza or Tel Aviv or Hebron, you're using the shekel, controlled by the Bank of Israel. There's only one highway system, one electrical system, one water system. By any measure, this already is one country, and it's an apartheid country. It is apartheid. Apartheid is defined in international law as having 2 elements to it. One is when one population separates itself from the others. That's apart. Apartheid means separateness. And you just have to look at the Israeli flag and you can see that. And then that population creates a regime. It isn't Jim Crow. It isn't just discrimination, which you have everywhere. It's a regime of permanent institutionalized domination. So when you have a regime of separation and domination, that's apartheid. And that's exactly what we have here. But I would argue that this is worse than apartheid. Apartheid is putting a good face on it. Apartheid is what the Labour Party wanted. That's what today the Labour Party, supposedly the opposition in Israel, you know, it's rebranded itself. It's not the Labour Party anymore. It ran in the last elections, and now its new name is the Zionist Camp. So the Zionist Camp is the left alternative to the Likud. They want apartheid. What the Likud wants, what Netanyahu and his partners want, is imprisonment. Because apartheid means there'd be a Palestinian Bantustan. Israel's saying, no, we're not going to give 10% of our country to Arabs. It's all ours. And we're going to imprison the Arabs. We don't use the word Palestinians because it gives too much recognition and legitimacy to a collectivity we don't want to admit exists. So we're going to imprison Palestinians in areas A and B and ghettos of Jerusalem and Gaza and inside Israel. And that's it. And that is called warehousing. Warehousing is a worse situation than apartheid. It's not political, and it's taken from the American prison system. Angela Davis is one of the people that has popularized the term warehousing for all the prisoners you have. You have a quarter of the prisoners of the world are in the United States. So that we're going to warehouse the Palestinians. Now, that's the option that Israel wants. That's where we are today, and Israel says we win. Israel is mopping up now with the support of the United States and Germany, which are the only two countries it cares about. It's immune. Nobody can sanction Israel. Nobody can do anything about it as long as those two countries are in its corner. And in the United States is a campaign of even not just delegitimizing, but making illegal BDS, the boycott, divestment, sanctions movement that we all used against the apartheid regime. We didn't buy grapes when we supported Cesar Chavez. That will become illegal. There are 30 states in the United States that have legislation to ban BDS. So it's not only government, but the government is imposing on the people. It's taking away the only popular grassroots way of resisting apartheid and warehousing. So Israel feels that it's won. It can't have won. I don't think apartheid warehousing is acceptable to any of us here. So we have to look for another way out. I think there's a third option that we haven't formulated yet, and that's one of our weaknesses. We haven't really formulated where we're going, where we're headed. And the Palestinians have to lead that, and for a lot of reasons, they're not doing it right now. But the third option is this, I think. You say to Israel, okay, you created one state. You, Israel, eliminated the two-state solution. Fine. We accept that. As a matter of fact, the Palestinians have always wanted one state. We accept that reality. But it cannot be an apartheid state, obviously. So the only way out is if we take that one state that Israel created and transform it into a democratic state of equal rights for all its citizens. Now that shouldn't be such a revolutionary idea for Americans. Oh, a democracy. Why didn't we think of that before? Yes, democracy. That's the way out. One equal state, equal rights for all its citizens, which means that Israel is going to have to bite the bullet, and it can't be a Jewish state. Israel will have to be transformed into something else. But the Palestinians also pay a price, because there'll also never be a Palestinian state that they've been yearning for the last century. But nevertheless, this is the way out, I think. There's even, what would the state be called? I have a little joke about that, just to insert a little humor into this discussion. You could call it Palestine if you spelled Stein, S-T-E-I-N. That's inclusive. All right, one democratic state. But I would add another element. Now here, until here, the Palestinians are pretty much with me. Israelis have a problem with that, obviously, Israeli Jews, in that, first of all, it's not a Jewish state, but that's less of a problem. The big problem is, they would say, what would we do about the tyranny of the majority? How would we prevent the Palestinians, who will be the majority, from doing to us what we do to them today? There's a law being passed in the Knesset, in the Israeli parliament today. It's passed the first reading of three, that says if you don't sign a document that you accept that Israel is a Jewish democracy, you can't run for parliament, you can't run for office, which is going to eliminate all the Arab representation in the Israeli parliament. So Israelis will say, in a bigger democracy, how do we prevent the Palestinian majority from doing the same thing to us? So that I think you have to add in another level of protection, but a meaningful level. I think this one democratic state would also have to be a binational state. Something like Canada. I mean, there's other models. Canada is Anglophile and Francophile. And the Francophile part, they have the parliament, they have a lot of control of institutions, they have their language, they have a lot of self-determination within the Canadian Federation. Britain is an example of that. Britain has four national groups, and the Scots are super nationalistic, and yet it's within one democratic state. Spain, Belgium, I mean, there's a lot of states in the world that are like that. So I would say, a binational. In other words, what does binational mean? It means that there's a constitution that Israel doesn't have today. There's a constitution of this new country that says it's a democracy for everyone. We have a normal parliament and everything. But we also recognize the integrity, the existence of two national groups in our country, Palestinian Arabs and Israeli Jews, and the integrity of those peoples will be respected. So for Israeli Jews then, you have two levels of protection in this kind of a state. One is normal protections of being a citizen in a democracy. The other one is collective protection of having your national group recognized, acknowledged, and protected. For Israeli Jews, the issue is not territory. Israeli Jews never bought into this greater land of Israel idea. There's not that many settlers given the Israeli population. What they're concerned about is security. And I think a binational state could go a long way towards addressing that. So I want to leave you on this piece with a slogan. And that is, again, we have always supported ICAHD, the Israeli Committee Against House Demolitions, the BDS movement. As a matter of fact, we were one of the initiators of the BDS movement. The first BDS campaign was against Caterpillar, that sells huge bulldozers especially designed to demolish Palestinian homes. So we've always supported BDS. We think it's a very important grassroots way of the people doing what governments should do and aren't doing. The weakness of BDS is that it's not connected to an end game. When we were BDSing South Africa, it was clear, one man, one vote. I mean, they might rephrase it these days, but then that was the end game. One man, one vote, and that's why we were boycotting South Africa. Here we don't have an agreed upon solution. And the Palestinians are in a very difficult situation. I don't have time to get into it, but they're in a transition. They haven't formulated. So I'm trying to kind of raise this binational democratic state to get just simply to get it into the discussion, to forward the discussion. So I would suggest a slogan, BDS for BDS. Boycotts, divestment, sanctions for a binational democratic state. And I think this is where we should be going. And I mean, you're not going to be able to do anything here. This is for to kind of, you know, sort of update you in terms of where we are. But back home in Israel-Palestine, I think this is what we have to really be working on, which isn't easy. Now, in the 2 minutes left, one of the questions, of course, that I asked all these years that is kind of implied in what we've just talked about is, how does Israel get away with this? I mean, why does the United States give this support to Israel? All of a sudden, China and India and Nigeria, that were always super pro-Palestinian, have turned 180 degrees and are supporting Israel. I mean, how do we explain that despite the fact that the Palestinians have, I think, the support of most of the peoples of the world, Israel has the support of most of the governments of the world? There's a tremendous disconnect between those levels. Why? What is Israel delivering? You know, I kept in mind this idea of Kissinger: countries don't have friends. They have interests. So what's the interest? And the usual explanations, AIPAC, you know, the Israeli lobby in Washington, which is powerful, Christian fundamentalists, Christian Zionists, guilt over the Holocaust, all these things work in particular places at particular times. But they're not a global, they don't explain India, for example. What explains the tremendous support that Israel gets from the international community? You know, a couple years ago, Israel was voted into the OECD, which is the exclusive club of the world's most advanced economies. And you have to be voted in unanimously. So here's 25 of the world's leading economies, the richest countries. So in that are the most educated people and the countries that most go for human rights, like Norway. And Israel was elected into the OECD unanimously, despite the fact that conformity to human rights is a precondition for getting into the OECD that obviously Israel didn't meet. So how do you explain that? Well, when you look up from the occupation, you begin to see a whole different picture of Israel emerging. Not this little tiny country that Israel always presents itself as, this little Jewish boy in a tough neighborhood, or the villa in the jungle is another image that Israel presents, but rather a pretty powerful country that's one of the main actors in the world's military security police trade. You know, it's very interesting that Israel's not only providing military and security equipment, but it's training police in the United States. Israel trains the LAPD. You say, what in the hell does Israel have to train the LAPD? It's one of the most brutal police forces in the world by itself. It invented SWAT teams. Why do you need Israel? And Israel, of course, is introducing both weaponry, because you have dual-use weaponry. You have weaponry that Israel just opened, the Israel weapons industry that does the Uzi and these kinds of, opened a factory in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania recently. And they're doing their weapons so that they're dual-use military police weapons. So the famous Uzi submachine gun is now made for law enforcement officers, but it can be put in a holster and it's like a big pistol. But it's still a submachine gun for law enforcement. So that it's a part of the militarization of the police. And why Israel? Because Israel has always had a militarized police. Unlike the United States, like other Western countries, always tried to separate the military out there, police domestic, CIA out there, FBI inside. That was a very important wall that was broken down largely by Homeland Security in 9/11. So the United States doesn't have that kind of dual-use weaponry because police weren't allowed, at least before 9/11, to have military equipment. The police in Britain weren't allowed to have guns at all. And now, of course, the police all over are being militarized. And so again, Israel is in the prime position of selling the appropriate arms and of militarizing the police. So to get to Art's question, I land in Atlanta last week. They take me right to Georgia State University in the heart of Atlanta. I'm giving a presentation. I look out the window, and there's the Gillie Center, G-I-L-E-E, which is the Georgia International Law Enforcement Exchange Center in the heart of Georgia State. It's an Israeli staffed, Jewish funded. It's a Marcus Foundation. This guy Marcus owns Home Depot. And he funds this Israeli program of bringing American police all over the country to Israel for training, which means you're all seen as terrorists, not as citizens, and bringing Israeli police here to train the American police. It's a center. It's a big building with a big sign in the middle of Georgia State. Nobody, the students have tried. Nobody, it's a black hole. Nobody can find out what the syllabus is, what the courses are, what they're teaching, who's teaching it, who's studying there. You know, it's this black security hole in the middle of a university. So that's just one example. When I came here, I stayed with Octavia near Hardwick. She's in a rural area. Right next door to her is the Massachusetts Police Academy. And she was talking last week. She was talking with some police guy that she's kind of a neighbor of hers. And he said, hey, you know, I just went through a great course taught by the Israeli police in Hardwick. I mean, Israel is really penetrating the American police and American security. I mean, Israel runs a lot of the American airports. No wonder it's the world's leader in security and biometrics, because you've got hundreds of checkpoints where Palestinians. Israel has this niche of security and policing. You know, Israel's not developing these weapons for Gazans. It's using Gaza to test the weapons. I write that about that in the book. But you're the end users. Gazans aren't. Gazans are the guinea pigs. You guys, your police department, are the ones that Israel wants to sell these things to. And so, literally, we're all Palestinians from the point of view of all of us are on the receiving end of weapons and tactics that are developed on the Palestinians and brought right into our communities here. In my view, this is a blind spot on the left. And I'm starting with me. I wrote a book about something I know nothing about. And it bothered me that if you take the military, security, and policing together, and certainly after 9/11, you see the militarization of the police here, and with wars against the people, it's the policification of the military. The militaries are going out for regime change and nation building and peace, all kinds of things, not wars anymore, in a sense. So, together. The military, security, and police are a $2.5 trillion a year industry that I think the people on the left know nothing about. We don't know anything about this. So I'm saying to myself, how can I be an activist and I want to change the world and I want to be, and I don't know anything about a $2.5 trillion a year industry with all the social, political, economic impact that has to have. So that I'm using Israel as a vehicle because Israel's a small country. So it has to scramble. And it has to niche fill, that's what it, you know, in order to supply the needs of the elites all over the world. And so Israel is, opens up, exposes the way that this whole system works much better than if I had taken a big country like the U.S. And so Israel is very much in this system. The quid pro quo becomes obvious. But beyond that, what I say also is that this is in the context of the world capitalist system. And what it exposes is the fact that as capitalism enters this crisis that it's in, it's unsustainable. I mean, Naomi Klein's new book on climate change and capitalism shows that very dramatically. It's income disparities out of this world. I mean, the 1%, 99%, which is not an exaggeration. Oxfam came out with a report 3 weeks ago that 1% of the world's population owns half the world's resources. As resources become more and more scarce, as more and more people are excluded from the system, 2/3 of humanity are defined by corporations as surplus humanity or disposable humanity, including people in this country. So as this system becomes more and more unsustainable and exclusive, it has to become more repressive. And because there's more resistance, people don't get excluded voluntarily. They're not poor voluntarily. They're not attacked and militarized or exploited voluntarily. And as that goes on, then the entire capitalist system and the elites need more and more weapons, tactics, surveillance devices, security in order to protect their hegemony. And that is much more an Israeli specialty than it is in an American. The Pentagon has an arsenal that's useless in what I call wars against the people. You can see it in Syria. Whereas Israel has 100 years of fighting a war against the people, the Palestinians, what we call today counterinsurgency or asymmetrical wars. And therefore, Israel becomes for the elites of the world themselves, but also for the capitalist elites, the go-to country when you're trying to find appropriate weapons and tactics and systems for controlling the people. And that's what my book is about. But also I'm trying to take my book and translate it into an online portal that will be accessible and more visual, a kind of a portal into this system as a resource for activists and young people. And it's a project that I've been involved with for a while. It's a part of the People Yes Network, which is a kind of a new organization that I'm involved in developing to try to get more coordination and communication and intersectionality among groups, left groups all over the world. Because I think peoples have pieces. As professors have pieces, Chomsky has a piece, David Harvey has a piece, some activists have pieces, Naomi Klein certainly has a piece of it. But there's no way in which our voices are kind of coming together in a strategic way where we can connect the dots and we can come up with a real unified sort of an analysis of not just of capitalism. That's the easy part. What's wrong with capitalism? What do we want to replace it with? And that we haven't really articulated for ourselves, and we certainly haven't articulated for the wider public. So I can see people saying, I mean, I think people out in the Occupy movement resonated with people. People saw, they know that it's not working, and it's not working in their benefit. But unless we, whoever the we are, you know, can take them by the hand in a sense and lead them somewhere else, where do you want us to go? They're not going to go there. And that we haven't done. So I think the first step is to begin to articulate for ourselves and then for the wider public, what is the alternative to capitalism? I mean, nothing less than that. That's where we are. I mean, Naomi Klein says, if we don't do this urgently, it's over. I mean, there's no alternative, in a sense. And so there's an urgency here. And, you know, the problem with the left is we're not very well organized for that. We're a herd of cats. We don't talk to each other very well, and we don't organize. And we, But I think we have to do that on a global level. I think one of the most destructive bumper stickers I've seen a few. Some of you might have had it on your car a few years ago. Think global, act local. Well, that's exactly what the corporations want you to do. Not act globally. So now we take all our activism, even if we understand the capitalist system globally, and we work locally. I mean, I'm not saying local work isn't important. It is. But somebody's got to act globally as well. And that's what I'm trying to do in this People Yes Network project, is to try to find people, both academics and activists around the world, who are willing to step back and look at the big picture and articulate where we could be going. What I'm talking about, a binational democratic state, is academic. And I joke with friends like Art that in English, academic means irrelevant. Something to think about. But there's no way to get there. But I think what's going to happen, and the Israeli government is having emergency meetings on this, is the Palestinian Authority is going to collapse. The Palestinian Authority is holding the lid on. They're like Israel's policemen. And preventing, of course, any alternative Palestinian voices from emerging. But I think it's going to collapse sooner rather than later. I mean, either Abu Mazen's going to resign, or worse, or it'll simply collapse because it has no credibility among its people anymore. When that happens, whether it's next week or next year, it's going to be, I think, in the short term. Abu Mazen is 80-some years old, which isn't as old as it used to sound. When that's the game changer. Because when the PA collapses, then I think Israel's, in that vacuum, Israel's going to have to reoccupy the Palestinian cities. It's going to have to reoccupy Gaza. Now there's no two-state solution. There's no negotiations. There's no political horizon. There's no both sides. And I think that raw, naked occupation and the chaos and the violence is going to inflame international public opinion. I think all over the world, including Europe and to some degree here. And I think it's going to be an untenable situation, especially given the general meltdown in the Middle East. Israel won't be able to deal with it. What's it going to do with 4.5 million people that are impoverished with no infrastructure? I don't think the United States can kick in and support the Palestinian people forever. And I think it's going to be and then that's the opening. If we're ready, and that's what I'm trying to urge on the left, especially in Palestine, now you have an opening for something new. The governments, including the United States, are going to impose an apartheid regime. I know what they're going to do. They're going to say, Israel, you annex Area C with all the settlements, and Areas A and B and Gaza will become a UN protectorate. And it'll be a kind of a nice face sort of an apartheid regime. That's what governments do. They manage conflicts. They don't resolve them, and certainly not in a just way. So if we want a just solution that I think is a binational democratic state, we on the left have to be the ones that articulate it and push it. And we're not doing that right now. That's really a problem. You hear the voice of the left a little bit protesting the occupation, but you don't hear proactive voices saying this is where we should be going. And my fear is that this collapse is going to happen, that opportunity opens up, and we're simply not ready. So I think if we were ready, I think the Israeli people, the Israeli Jews, they're not going to be proactive. Like in South Africa, the whites weren't going to rise up and overthrow apartheid. But like in South Africa, I think if Israeli Jews could be convinced that their security is ensured, they would not be an obstacle to this. When the de Klerk moment comes and the occupation is unsustainable and something just has to replace it, I think Israeli Jews would go there. So they're not going to be the proactive actors, but at the same time, I think they're more willing to entertain that option than we think they are today. That's a good place to end.
Tell you a story, make it clear as I can, about the faraway troubles in the Holy Land. Pictures of the children etched in your mind, laying down their bodies on the firing line.